departed this life, she departed this life, her heavenly glory, by being comforted by her loving friend and family in her home. Mary was a loving mother and wife who cherished her God and family above all else in the world. I believe that. I sure do. Mary was born on August the 12th, 1927, in Whitesburg, Kentucky. Actually, that was Linefork, Kentucky, wasn't it, Joanne? That's the nearest town we had to Georgia B. and Carlisle. Georgia B. was a great minister, pastor, a leader in that community. Married everybody, married my mom and daddy over 100 years ago. And just wonderful family. She grew up in the mountains of southeastern Kentucky, surviving the poverty era of the Great Depression. We barely made it through that, my friend. In 1948, and enjoyed a loving and happy marriage until his passing in 2007. She met and married her late husband, Willmer, in 48, and enjoyed a loving and happy marriage until his passing. The Halcomb family moved to Carlisle, Kentucky in 1971. Mary was employed at the jockey company and became very active and the Nicholas County Homemakers and several other organizations for women. She was a lifelong member of the Cedar Grove Old Anglican Baptist Church in Hattie, Kentucky. And by the way, they just told me she was the oldest living member at the time she died. And a 50-year member of the Order of the Eastern Star in Greenville, Kentucky. Mary was a talented cook and baker, an avid creator of art projects, and an accomplished painter. She greatly enjoyed hosting large gatherings of her family, and very recently entertained over 40 friends and family members in her home to celebrate her 90th birthday. Mary also immensely enjoyed gardening and fishing. If you married a hawk, you better be a fisherman, because you would have been a lot of time at home yourself. In addition to her husband, Mary was preceded in death by her son, Willmer, three brothers and sisters. She is survived by her daughter, Pamela Halcomb of Danville, Kentucky, her son, daughter, and son-in-law, Willmer, and Richard Archie of Georgetown, Kentucky, her grandson, Jeremy Archie of Los Angeles, California, and five sisters and two brothers. The family would like to express sincere gratitude to Lincoln Vanity Bluegrass Hospice Care, and what a great job they did. Independence Assistance and Bluegrass and Meals on Wheels for their gracious and professional support during Mary's final months. This support left Mary in the past with comfort and dignity in the home she had lived in for nearly 50 years, and in the presence of those who loved her dearly.
Amen. how we cried the day you left us. We gathered around your grave to grieve. I wish I could see the angels' faces when they hear
Boy, same. Bill Lester went to the same school, and Mary Della went to the same school. We did all of us went to the same school. We had to walk, had no pleasure. And we knew what it was to work too. We had to work coal corn, plant corn, milk the cow, feed the hog. This is the kind of life we live. But thank God.
The Lord is high. To say hello and sat down on a hard rock and put his shoes on. I remember this as good as if it was today. He only had 1 mile more to the house where he lived. Man, did he walk fast. I'll tell you what, I bet he walked that 9 mile in probably, I don't know, 30 minutes or 40 minutes. And all the time had Mary on his mind, that one he loved so much. There was no blacktop road, only dirt and mud. Oh. Soon after this, we're married. We're married, and God bless them to be successful. raised a wonderful, wonderful family. They became true believers in God and was baptized in the Cedar of the church and was a member there until their death. Mary was a virtuous woman. I don't know if you all understand what a virtuous woman is. She's just not one today and something else tomorrow. She lived a virtuous life. Loved her husband and supported him in his honey business. And loved by all that knew her. Everybody I knew had my family. We had 12 in our family. And my mom, if one family was in trouble, the other family would help. We didn't have, none of us were rich. We didn't have where to survive. But we had love. Mary was taught me. So God bless you.
Says, I believe Paul wrote it, I reckon that the sufferings of this world this present time is not to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. You know, the suffering that she has been through, the real hard times here lately has been really, really hard for her family. But that's past now. It's over. And you can't even compare the time of her suffering with the eternity of glory that she has now entered into. This life has just been just a short dream to her. But when it come dying time, it was just her and the Lord, and she needed him more than she needed the family. And when it comes dying time for you and I, we will need God more than we need the family. 7 years ago, she knew that this hour was coming, and she made arrangements by repenting. But first, she believed the gospel. She believed the report. When she believed it, she repented. She became a doer of it. And the Bible says when you heard the words of truth, she heard it. When you hear the gospel of your salvation, she heard it. And when you believe it, she believed it. Then are you sealed? She was sealed. With the Holy Spirit of promise and having this seal, she had it. The Bible says God knows them that are his. Ain't that wonderful? That God knows them that are his. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they do follow me. And he said, I give unto them eternal life. 20 years old, God gave her eternal life. And Jesus said, they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. For my Father, which gave them to me, he's greater than all. And no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. Jesus said, my Father and me, we are one. Ain't that wonderful?
Yeah.
Sister Mary, yeah, she had to leave this life. And she's entered into a world that I believe that she knows a whole lot more now than she has known in her whole life. And the Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. You can't get any better than that. There's a scripture in the Bible that says, in his presence is fullness of joy, and at his right hand there are pleasures forevermore. There is no more sickness, no more pain, no more death, no more suffering, no more heartaches, no more long, sad nights, no more worry, no more doctor's appointments, no more tests. That, the former things have all passed away, and behold, all things become new. The Bible teaches us that it's precious in the eyes of the Lord. Precious are the death of his saints in the eyes of the Lord. God does not do this to make us sad or to hurt us, but this is just a part of life that we all have to face, and it's going to happen to all of us. But the good part about it is the Bible said, blessed are the dead that die in the Lord. From henceforth, yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow after them. She has been seeking a rest for a long time. The scripture says there remaineth a rest for the children of God, and my goodness, what a rest she has entered into. I believe it's just like, she is just like, remember little Lazarus, the beggar? The Bible says when he died, he was carried by the angels to the bosom of Abraham, and there, the Bible says he was being comforted. He was at rest. And I believe that the Sister Mary Della, that she too, that right now is the best part of her life, of her very being, is because that the Bible says the body, that the spirit is going back to God that gave it. This little body is all that we have. But the real Sister Mary that we all knew, she's still alive. She's more alive today than we've ever known it. This is just a little tabernacle that she lived in. The Apostle Paul said, we know that if this earthly house, this tabernacle were dissolved, that we have a building, a house, not made with hands, and that house is eternal in the heavens. This is not going to heaven, folks. Flesh and blood is not going to enter into the kingdom of heaven. But what we have here today is dying. It died in hope. David said, I know my Redeemer. I believe it was. He said, Job said, I know my Redeemer liveth, and he shall stand in the latter day upon the earth. And though after the skin worms devour this body of mine, yet in my flesh shall I see God. And he said, and I shall see him for myself and not another. And David wrote about the Lord, how that he would not leave his soul in hell, how he not suffer to the corruption. And he said, this body also shall rest in hope. Meaning that she was looking, this outward man is looking for a new body. And the Bible says it does not yet appear what that body shall be. But we know that when Jesus shall appear, we shall be like him. And as one of the writers of old said, when we awake in the likeness of the Lord, then we'll be satisfied. No matter how close we get to God in this life, or how good our church services are, there's still something lacking. We'll never be satisfied until we hear Jesus say, come, ye blessed of my Father. You've been faithful over a few things. I'll make you ruler over many. Enter the joys of the Lord and just come on in. Won't that be a wonderful time when Jesus comes riding the clouds of glory, and the Bible says all of the berries are going to hear the voice of the Son of God, and they're going to get up first, they that die in the Lord. And we right now, if that should happen, all of us in this house that are Christians, we would be changed in a moment and a twinkling of an eye, and we would be caught up together with her in that brand new body to be with the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. So it ain't bad, folks. It's not bad at all to die in the Lord. But the Apostle Paul said, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. He said, I'm in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better. Now, ain't that wonderful? We can close with that. To live is Christ, and to die is gain.
Coming from his throne in glory, man in flesh, yet God divine, he walked along as pure and holy, spotless Lamb, though he did shine in his
fly your spirit.
baptizing when we ever joined the church. And he came down to the riverbank, and Brother Squire, Brother Elwood was out in the water with somebody else, and Brother I.D. and me just got through baptizing somebody who was down there. Brother Wilmer was not in church. He walked up and he said, I can't say the words he said. His vocabulary is much greater than mine, but it was something like this. According to my experience with God, I would like at this time to demand my right to be baptized. And he said, I want to present myself for water baptism. I've never heard it put like that in my life. Brother I.D. started shouting. He said, come on, Brother Will. We was out in the water before they had to move in the second to take him into the Wash Girls Church. And we baptized him there that day. And he was so happy.
My mother was a very hard worker. She stayed true to her faith all the years that I've known her. She grew up in a profound poverty, did not have enough food to eat as a child, but she and my dad, in spite of it or because of it, they worked hard, they worked as a team, and they made a good life.
And love.
And I will miss her so much. She would always call me at 9 o'clock every morning to see what was going on. And I will miss those phone calls.
Yeah. I'm going to go to see them and they spark a little bit. And then come bedtime. You didn't get to stay past bedtime.
No.
Not. Joanne, get in the bed.
Don't keep that boy up all night and it'd be just
there. And if they stay 5 minutes too late, here he come. They'd have to skin the post down. You've been there most of them, maybe. They'd skin that post and get down. That's how they were then. You know, you come from one of the greatest families that there ever was. Greatest family that you could ever come from.
I heard Dad say, you going to keep that boy up all night? Don't you think you better let him go home?
I remember they had a grocery store.
Yeah.
Probably don't remember. It's that beautiful place. Had a real nice, where you put the candy and stuff.
Showcase.
Yeah, showcase. It's a beautiful, beautiful place. By the time it burnt down, I tore it down. A landmark would have been today what it would have been. But out by that storehouse, we had several pear trees and apple trees and being held. And the schoolhouse was just 150 yards from where they lived. They didn't have to go far. And they had we don't have the trees. You don't have apples like we had. We really had apples. They had a sweet grass. Is that what that the name was?
And sweet apple tree then was a
and a peeping apple.
Peeping apple. Yeah. Yellow peeping.
I might have told you something, but he'd go, I'd say 75 foot high.
Yellow peeping.
Way over. Well, those young kids couldn't go up high enough to get them in the top of the tree, so we'd have to wait till someone bigger than us had a little more power and throw and it knocked one out and it was a battle to get to the apple. But there's always one, two, or three, Joanne Maywood and Joanne stayed right on the top of that tree then.
Yeah.
Laid in the seat and we keep throwing rocks at it. And all them girls, I guess, and boys was watching us. They didn't want us to get their apples. They didn't have that many apples. But anyway, finally someone to come along and make the right throw with a rock and knock that last apple off. So we're going to conclude our service shortly. But remember this, we're going to leave this with you. I hope you will take this as a grain of salt. So important. Be prepared to die when God calls you, because you don't know when it's going to be. Right, James?
That's right.
Maybe tonight when you get home.
That's right.
Tomorrow. Get ready to meet the Lord. That's what we're supposed to tell you, and this is what Mary would want us to tell you.
Mm-hmm.
Prepare yourself. Well, you say, how do we do that? Well, what you really, if you have a Bible at home, which you, I hope you do have, it's a book of all of the best. Open it up and read it. But we are all sinners. Everybody that was born to a woman is born to sin. But Jesus Christ came to offer himself as a sacrifice, that if we would believe in him, we should live forever.
Mm-hmm.
Get him on your bond, take him home where you lay down at night, and when you pray, pray for me, would you? Pray for all of us.
Yes.
Pray for each other, because life will soon be over.
Yeah.
Keep telling me that, Brother Whitaker. I keep getting warning signals. My wife tells me of my mistakes.
Yeah, that's great.
That's okay. That's all right. Nothing wrong with that. Some wonderful day, they will see us for the last time.
Yeah.
And this is what's going to count. What have we done for Jesus Christ?
Amen.
That gave his life.
Well, yeah, but.
And may the family visit this place often. And it's a good place to come and find yourself for a few minutes, reminiscing about the past. And God of heaven, bless this family.
Yes, Lord.
Bless the young people in this family. The elderly, the sick today that's not here. And God, as we journey home, please give us a safe trip back to our home and our family. And we pray for the young man that has to go all the way to Los Angeles. God, we pray for him.
Yes, Lord.
His mother and his dad.
Yes.
Pray for our neighbors. God, we pray for the leaders of this nation of ours.
Amen.
What a terrible shape we're in, because we have left you out of that plan. Bless these two sisters, God, that work their little hearts out for their mother. Try to keep her alive even when she was dying. God, we thank you for the witness of Sister Mary Ellen Halcomb.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, God, for the undertakings that done a good job. Give us a free hand. We pray that you bless them and that they'll not forget where their blessings come from.
Yes, Lord.
In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we ask all these things and hoping to meet someday.
Amen.
In heaven. However you got it fixed up, we'll be satisfied. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.